morning.
How you guys doing today? My name is Isaiah Anderson. I'm here with the Jonesboro Library and the Clayton County Library System. And today I'll be running a program that teaches you music production 101. Now, this lesson today, it will be derived in predominantly hip-hop and R&B production. But I feel like if you want to produce any kind of music, this would be a program that can help you learn the steps of how to craft your own song, your own beat. So come along with me and I'll dive into the process of how I produce music. Okay, so my first step always with production is I want to figure out how fast or how slow I want the beat to be. And that is signified by a word named the tempo. And today we're using a program called FL Studio, but you can do this in any other music production program, whether it's Reason or Logic or Mixcraft, but you set your tempo with your metronome, and your metronome is how many beats you keep. So I'll turn on my metronome here. My metronome is pretty fast, but it's set at a 142 beats per minute. So I'll play that so you can hear how that sounds. 1, 2, 3, 4. So I'm gonna take the 142 BPM and build a rhythm off of that. Rhythm is drum bass, it's percussion bass, it's hi-hat, snares, claps, kicks, you know, cymbals, different things like that. So just to keep my beat so I don't have to play my metronome all the time, I'll lay my hi-hats down. And my hi-hats is something like this. Pretty simple. But if you play it with the metronome, you can see how it keeps the beat. Hold on. You see? So with that, with the hi-hats is basically gonna be your main movement throughout your track the whole time. Like, it can come in, it can come out, but it's always gonna add more movement. But with the movement, you need something that's called a bounce. And a bounce is thrown off with a kick and a snap, clap, or snare. So it can give you the rhythm of how to bob your head. Because if you just play this hi-hat, it's consistent, right? But it doesn't tell you where the stress on the beat is. So if you add a clap in there, you see? But see, the secret to adding a clap is to count the beats. So if we go back to the metronome, you can count it like 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And the trick for the clap is always to put the clap on the 2 and the 4. See? 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now see, I threw a little flavor in there, you know, put it on a little and beat, but if you play the clap and the hi-hat together, you get. Pretty simple, right? Okay. So with that, I always like to make my beat have a lot of layers. And you can add layers by just stacking sounds. So with my clap, I always add a snare on top of it to give a change up as the beat goes on. And this would be a thing that we'll come back to at the end when I'm talking about how to sequence a beat. But see, if I put the clap and the snares together, they sound like this. This is the clap by itself, and this with the snare. Hear the difference? So this is basically gonna be your main groove for the beat, and all the music you put on this record will be centered around this rhythmic section of this hi-hat, snare, clap. And the last thing to really give you your full rhythmic section would be your kick. Every other percussion instrument after this, to me, is what I call ear candy. It's something that I add just to give a little spice on the end. But this kick is what will set your foundation for your beat. So I already laid a kick down. It was pretty simple. The beats on this is really centered around how you want to focus your kicks in between the first and the fourth beat. Remember when I was counting the metronome and it goes 1, 2, 3, 4? So the beats in between the 1, 2, and 3, and 4, minus that one beat, the first beat, is important for you to play with your kick. So if I turn on the metronome and play the kick, you can see what I mean a little better. So it's like 1. You see how the kick always hits on the 1 though? As long as you have one kick to hit on the 1, wherever your kicks fall along the metronome, it'll balance out once you put it with your hi-hats and your claps. So I'll play that, for example, like this. So this is going to be our main groove for this beat. Hear the snare on top? Okay. Now, when I have a good groove, I usually like to go to an instrument next so I can start to figure out what I want this beat to say to me. Now, when I say to me, I mean I look at music like a conversation. I look at notes like tones of a voice, anger, sadness, happiness. So with this, I kind of get kind of an aggressive feeling, but to me, it's still kind of calm, a little smooth, even though it has a lot of energy. And that's kind of the luxury of figuring out where to put your kicks and where to put your hi-hats, more specifically, because on most beats, the snare and the clap fall in the same place on beat 2 and 4. So with this, I feel a bass line that is needed for me to fully get how I feel about these drums across. So I usually try and choose a bass that rattles, but today I'm gonna do something a little more smooth. So this is a bass line. See? So with me, I kind of had the idea to do a pretty simple bass line like this. You see? So I'll play it with the beat. You see? So for example, that by itself, it'll sound like. To me, that always felt a little, like if I just repeated that through the beat, I feel like it'd get a little monotonous, a little same, a little boring. So I like to do one melody and then do another melody with the same instrument to extend the phrasing. The phrasing is the counts of four put together. So one beat is four counts. So a phrase is more than one beat put together, right? So four counts make one beat. More than one beat makes a phrase. Multiple beats put together is a phrase, okay? So on the second part of my phrase, I changed up the notes a bit, and it was like that, right? So, right? So I'll play that for you, show you how I did it. So that, with all my drums and my rhythm section, got a little something to work with now. See? See? Now, at this point, I like to start to think about the song as a whole, because to me, you never want to overexert yourself with adding instruments, with adding drum sounds, with adding feeling to music. Because like I said, I look at music like a conversation. And it's kind of hard to convince someone that you feel a way if you're making a whole bunch of points at once. So with production, you kind of have to make your points strong and not try to make as many points as you can. So with this, it's like I have a bass, which is one instrument, and I have drums. But to me, it still feels like it could add a little more character to it. So I like to throw in things like open hats to make the drums seem a little more alive. Like this is an open hat sound. Right? So if I play that with the hi-hats and the snares, I have it playing like this usually to come before the clap. So it can add a little more just flavor to when it hits. So look, 1 second. See? So with the bass line, it goes. Right? So now with this, I usually like to just start to fill out chords or a sound that makes the beat feel full. And usually that could be a keys or rolls or a pad, something that's spacious. So now we're at a point of the beat where we're gonna create new music to add on top of this bass line, okay? So with this bass line, I play all white keys. And that means we're in the key of C major, which isn't quite important to this lesson and what key we're in, but I just wanted you to know so you could see how do I know what keys to play and what could work. You see all the white keys? They don't sound like they don't fit, right? So it's about finding multiple notes that work together to create a chord or a triad, which is three notes strung together, played at once. So, you see? So, we'll go ahead and record that because to me that sounds good. It feels good. I usually don't go off sound, I go off feeling. So, I always go with feeling because sound, it might confuse you. You might overstep. You might think twice. Never that. Go with your first feeling when you're making production. So, wait. Those are my two chords right here. Pretty simple. I'm not even gonna do that a lot, you know, because I think if I overdo it, it'll take away from this bass line, which is the main focus in these drums. So listen to this. This beat to me, it has a lot of low end, a lot of bass, a lot of frequency that rumbles. So here to me it seems like I need to add something that's more on the high end, something that's more light, something that's more not necessarily soft, but something that accents the higher end of the beat along with the hi-hat, something that resonates in a higher frequency. So I like to try and add a bell or some kind of percussion instrument that adds to the top end of the track, like a mallet or some kind. But it's always a journey to find the sound. So searching for sounds is pretty much a everyday thing. So my biggest takeaway from learning how to produce is always look for new sounds. Someone in this world has not used the sound that you can find, and always look for it. Look for the coolest sample, the sound that no one has ever used before, or even if it's a sound you've heard before, try and use it a different way. Play it in a different cadence, you know, tune it. I like to, you know, me and my producer friends, we call it tweaking it, where we come into a place where they have a sound and we add extra effects to it to make it sound like a new sound, you know? So always look for new sounds and always try and find sounds that complement where you want to go musically and melodically. So. Here it's pretty smooth, but But this to me seems like more of a background sound, a sound that you would add to just add a little more life and character to your record. Not necessarily something you would hear, but more so something that you can feel. Like, you hear the sound and you're like, I don't know what that is, but it's doing something to me, you know? A lot of sounds like that are usually tucked or hidden in the back of beats. So this would probably be one of the second to last sounds I add to this beat, because the next most important thing isn't having a plethora of sounds, is how you organize those sounds in song format, which is my last point called sequencing. So after I add these last two sounds, we'll go dive into sequencing a record. And this will be a pretty short beat, probably about 2 minutes or so, but I'll teach you guys how to count phrases for a verse, a hook, and different things of that nature. So here's my new melody I'm working out. So what I can do though is I'm going to take the chords that I played for my keys here, and I'm going to put it on this sound, but instead of playing it in the same phrasing, I'm going to arpeggiate it. And arpeggiating is basically when you take a chord with three or more notes and you play the notes in a specific order. So like this. Or whenever you hear something like this, that's called an arpeggiator. Or arp, sometimes confused with the word harp, you know? But that's why they call it a harp, because it's the same technique of an arpeggiator. You see? So, put these notes down. Sometimes I like to click notes in instead of playing them in, just so I can have a little more control on how I want them to sound or where I want them to be placed. And I'll take this sound here and I'll create an arpeggiator out of it. Let me play it. Come on. You see, this is gonna be a fast arp. Listen. But we don't want that. We don't want that. We want something a little more slow, a little more cadence friendly. So we're gonna add a different range too. With me, when I hear sounds like this and melodies like this, it kind of changes the beat for me in my head. So I'm going to go and play what I've created and take out the bass line just to show you how this one pattern works within the rest of the beat. So we got something to work with, you know? Woo! All right. Sorry, you guys. I was getting in my bag right there. But yeah, so these are the basic steps of how to create a music production. Now, this could be with any genre. It could be hip-hop, it could be R&B, it could also be used for country, it could be used for techno and house. These are all steps that help build out a beat, you know? These are not things that are specifically genre-specific, you know? These are all kind of music techniques, you know? You're always going to need a rhythm section, always going to need a bass, always going to need a main melody, and you're always going to need ear candy. So, now, after that, you're going to need your sequence, because if I just play this beat, it does nothing for me. Like, it's good, but it doesn't really build me up, take me down, take me through anything, you know? So I like to take beats and basically strip the beginning. Like, I usually just strip the beginning of all sounds, unless I want to start it with one of the main sounds. So with this beat, I think I'm going to do a bass. It's going to start with the bass because the bass to me is like the focal point still, even after I added my arp. So, hold on. This bass line right here. And then after that, I like to, you know, start just adding a few different things. Every four bars, I try to add a new sound. When I say new, I don't mean a new one that I haven't added, but just a new piece of music that they hadn't quite heard yet. So, like this. Now, so with me, when I'm making a verse, this intro is about usually 8 bars or 8 count. So 1, 2, 3, 4. And then another 4 count. 1, 2, 3, 4. You see? So with that, I usually leave that as a simple intro, just usually 8 bar count. And my verses is usually either anywhere from 12 to 16. Because in R&B and hip-hop music, they usually have 16 or 12 bar phrases. I actually don't know the history behind that. I want to look into that. You know, I think it comes from blues, but, you know, that's a conversation for another day. So, you see? So, it's the first 4 beats. And you see how, like, in the second 4 beats, the bass line changed. So it's always about adding something new every four beats. It don't have to be something that you hadn't heard. It could be taking something out. It could be adding something. But it's important to add that to your beat. Take everything out here. And then after this, we go right back to the verse. So, this beat here is pretty simple. How I set up the hook was a little non-traditional. So, I like to, you know, give pointers and say these are steps that you can take. But the most important thing is to remember when you're making music is to use your steps, but never marry the process. Because the process is always going to change. It's always going to be something different you have to do on this beat that you didn't have to do on this beat because of the sounds you chose or the drum sound you wanted to use or the instrument you liked or the tempo of the beat. So always figure out those steps. Pay attention to the steps, but don't marry the process, you know? Marry the sounds, you know? Marry the confidence and the repetition that you need to succeed. Excel in just crafting something, but you know, that's to me is the most important thing is, you know, marry the sounds, don't marry the process. And so this beat here is pretty simple. You know, it took me about 15-20 minutes to craft it, but it's not about the time you spent, it's about the intent you had when you were making it. So this is a beat. if you guys have a cool name for it, you know, you can leave it in the comments. You know, I might, you know, try and figure out a way to get you guys to have some access to this instrumental so you can hear it. But yeah, my name is Isaiah T. Anderson. This is my beat in my music production 101 class.